Hello, welcome to another Retro Rehearsal Part this week with the amazing Josie Long. This is a good one. There's a great story about a car crash in this. Really good. One of my favourite bits of the entire run of 100 we've done so far. Hey, look, we're doing some more of these in June and July. Come down to the Leicester Square Theatre and see them. I am trying to get the guests sorted out now. I've got a couple of possibles, but no one I can mention yet. But all the shows are good. And when we get a big name, it sells out straight away. So it might be wise to just take a chance and come and see the one that you want to come and see and then see who it turns up. And we're trying to work out how we're going to pay for it. We might do a Kickstarter later in the year for both series. It just seems too soon to another Kickstarter. There's a clue up here as to another idea I've got for making some money. So we'll see. We'll find some way to do it. And I'm still on tour with Happy Now. It's coming to the end. The April, well, thank you if you came in April. That was very hard, lots of work and lots of gigs. But I am in Windsor on the 7th of May. Lots of tickets left for that for some reason. Belfast on the 8th, that's sold out. But I'm in Belfast and Dublin in 2017. And there'll be more seats in the Belfast one. And then there's a few more coming up in Chelmsford, sold out on the 19th. Cambridge on the 20th, nearly sold out. Didcot on the 21st, that usually sells out, but there's still quite a lot of tickets for that. Norden Farm in Maidenhead on the 28th of May, and then there's a couple of new gigs added in Leeds on the 9th of June, Peterborough on the 10th of June, and then the final ever performance, I think, unless I go back and do 24 shows all in 12 weeks sometime in the future, will be at the Leicester Square Theatre on June the 12th, and that's selling okay as well. So if you, those are your last chance to see this show, Happy Now, which is one of my favourite shows I've done, and I think it's pretty good. We will see what you think. You can let me know via Twitter. I'm sure you will anyway. Anyway, let's sit back and relax and enjoy this week's I'm stuck in a time warp. There must be some way out. Just say something different. Okay, I have done. Good. Bye. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Leicester Square Theatre. Please welcome a man who is now saying more words than he has done in the last hour and 15 minutes. It's Richard Herring! Thank you! Oh, you aren't as good as last week's audience. They kept applauding until I was speaking. Wait, hello, welcome to Richard Herring's Leicester Square Theatre podcast. There's all the cool kids calling it Rehelestapur. Yeah, that's more like it. We're having some fun. I was very much enjoyed recently talking to Danny Baker last week. It seems like only yesterday there's some lads arriving here with booze. That's what you need, to be boozed up for this. They're arriving. There's probably some kind of stag night. They look at that guy. He looks quite dangerous. Can't quite see him. Oh no, he's all right. He's just. What's your name? Carl, you thought you were safe back in row three, didn't you? But you were very, very wrong. What's your favourite Spice Girl? Mel B. Mel B. Interesting. What do you like about her? Her hair or her? I like her. I like all of her. Her hair. That's nice. You like hair on a woman? Yeah, that's good. Like a woman with hair. Yeah, well, I don't mind either way. It's recently International Women's Day, do you know? Do you know when International Men's Day is? That's what I wonder. When is it? Oh, that's good. You were paying attention. I like women with hair all over them, don't you? That's why. I mean, it's nice if they've got it on their head. It doesn't have to be. I'm not having a go. It doesn't have to be. But, I think they're mammals, right? Mainly, most women. That's part of the definition of a man. I feel like everyone's having a go at me for saying I like hairy women. And now, as if I like hairy women. Shut up, fuck you. With your prejudice. It's going very well. So there's a couple of newer people. Hello there, how are you doing? A couple of newer people. I've gone quite professional. I've actually slipped my hand
into the camera strap for the first time ever, which is slightly confusing me about how to make the camera work. Hello, what's your name?
Jenny.
Jenny, that's a beautiful name. And what's your name?
Alex.
Alex, that's not you. And you can't be together because you are very attractive and he is extremely ugly. So that is... Are you together in a relationship? What? You caught her when she was young. Were you also young? If I was 48 years old, and I found, met her when she was 4. Just biding my time, didn't break any rules. So what do you do, Alex, for a job?
Oh, I work in a shop.
You work in a shop? You really? You can move, you can leave him, you can go to someone else. Which shop do you work in? Jewelry shop. Ooh, now it all starts to add up. If I came to your jewelry shop and you said that ring is £3,000, and I said, you know, I don't need a receipt for that, would that make? If I call you Chaz, yeah, of course. That would be. I was going to call you Chaz anyway. And you were worried about being picked on because you tweeted earlier on. That was very foolish. What's your name? Joe, what do you think I would be rude to you? I wouldn't be rude. Oh, you might have to leave to catch your train. Oh, well, if I see that happening, I'm going to lambast you, don't you worry. Where are you going on your train, old Mrs. Fancy Pants? Oh, I might have to leave to catch my train. I'm not walking home like everyone else. Where do you come from? You live in Surrey?
Don't worry,
Surrey's fine. Tell you went temporarily. What are you doing out in Surrey? You're emigrating from Surrey or from somewhere? You've got a slight accent. I'm a bit like Henry Higgins. Let me just... I've heard enough. Is it somewhere outside of the United Kingdom? I was expecting a bit more. Is it from... Are you from the African continent? Yeah, I've almost got it straight away. You're from Johannesburg. Where are you from? Cape Town's the fucking same place. What's wrong with you? Were you? Oh God, I've got so many awful questions. And I started asking two of them and I stopped them both. Welcome, you're gonna come and live in our country? Oh, you're moving from England to Germany. What's wrong with you? Wasn't the place you're from right-wing enough for you? Honestly, that is not as bad as the two things I stopped myself. You're very welcome, even though, why do you want to go to Germany? What's going on? What's wrong with it? What's wrong with Surrey?
My husband's...
Your husband, your imaginary husband. Where is this husband?
In Berlin, right?
Oh, that's okay. Oh, that's all right. Everyone can be by himself. He's by himself as well. He kind of sat down there, thought, I'll take, there's a one on his own, I can pick her off. To be honest, I've just picked on you so that I can get a picture of him if anything happens to you tonight. We've at least got the ever, we'll catch him. That is the main thing. Well, so you're most welcome. Sorry, I did in the end. You shouldn't have tweeted to me. It was all right in the end, right? Yeah, phew. So look, we're going to move on with my car crash audience participation. I mean, I don't know why I try. It's always like you come every week. It's pretty much always this bad, isn't it? One day I'll get good at it. That's why you're all thinking, how did we get away with it? There's two pretty women and a bald man. How did they get away with it? Wrong with me? I think it's just the excitement about being able to speak. I genuinely think that's what it is. Anyway, our guest tonight is probably best known for her work on GCSE bite-sized history, or possibly you will know her from improvisation, my dear Watson. Will you please welcome Josie Long? It's Josie Long. Come in, sit down, pick up that microphone and use it like you would a microphone.
Hello. Thanks.
How are you doing?
I'm great, thank you. Thanks for having me on directly after the most incredible radio personality in the world.
Yeah.
Fascinating.
It was good. It's all going to be fine. So tell us about bite-sized GCSE history. How was that working
on
it?
The guy, there's this one guy who likes me,
yeah,
and he keeps getting me in for all of these things. Bite-sized GCSE history I've done,
yeah.
Bite-sized A-level something, and I did an Open University thing that was like a taster of all.
Does it count as a qualification if you've done on?
I've got a B now.
Pretty much now, A-level is just a bite-sized thing. Do you know what English is? Yeah. All right, yep. That's an A.
Because it can also get an A star.
Yeah,
now.
That's right. What kind of facts did you teach in GCSE?
I can't remember. You have to do it really quickly. You don't take it in. You just say it in an appealing way.
Wow.
And then you fuck off out there. Also, can I say we were just... Because I was just watching Danny Baker, and now all I want to do is be like, get the money, knock it out. Knock it straight out. That's what I've done. GCSE, give us a fucking...
Who needs GCSEs? They didn't even have GCSEs when Danny Baker was a lad. And what about improvisation, my dear? They didn't have GCSEs when I was a lad either, I should add. I've got 11 O-levels. I stayed at school. Look what happened to me. Improvisation, my dear Watson, which I think is the worst title of any TV show ever.
Do you know the guy who produced it is a really nice guy?
That doesn't excuse his appalling...
He's so pleased with himself for coming up with
it. That is such a bad... it's hosted by Mark Watson. So that's the my dear Watson. Improvisation, my dear Watson.
Yeah, it makes perfect sense.
It does not. Improvisation does not even sound like elementary. They never said elementary, my... And Sherlock Holmes never actually said elementary, my dear Watson, anyway. So that would be my first port of call. I get very upset about... I'm quite pedantic. It should be Nevermind Buzzcocks. They're called Buzzcocks, not The Buzzcocks. And also, why not just call it Nevermind the Bollocks? It's pathetic. So anyway, that's not your fault.
It's not my fault.
It's not. But what did you improvise on my...
Did
you improvise something and then go, thank you, my dear Mark Watson?
I just improvised clues. That's what I did. It was one of those things where you do it and then they go, in the rehearsal you do it and they go, brilliant.
The rehearsal?
Exactly.
The rehearsal?
So I'll do that exactly again. And you're like, that's not improv. That's the opposite. But I've done it and then I've fucking got the money and I knocked it. I'm sorry.
Do you like to spend your money when you've got your money?
Yeah, I really do. I like to spend like a Saudi prince.
Do you?
Yeah. But I sort of have this weird uncomfortable thing with money because I don't like the idea of being wealthy at all. And luckily, my career has helped me in that aim. But then I do really like luxury goods a lot.
Yeah.
So I really like champagne and delicious foods.
Yeah.
But I also have this thing where I'm like, the wealthy are disgusting. But this dessert wine is not from a good enough year. And if you could swap it, really.
It is, but I think if you've got the money, spend the money. And, you know, the champagne industry, the people... The workers there need to earn some money. I'm going to get straight into this because this might take some time. This is the Dirty Britcom Confessions website, which I thought someone as sweet as Josie Long, though some of the things she was saying backstage were appalling.
That's because... Oh, I can't... Can I not?
No, you can't say. There's a secret. She's... A lot of them are very sweet for you, which is nice, but some of them aren't. Fantasy, colon, that isn't the fantasy, that's punctuation. Josie Long and I are sitting next to each other on a train. Our fingertips
touch.
Our fingertips touch briefly.
Is there any way to find out who wrote them?
No, that's why they're...
Anonymous, okay.
They're anonymous, but you know, I think if you like them, the person who might be listening to this, they might send in their name. Some other men who didn't write this might go, she liked it, didn't she, Josie? Yeah, that's me, you can do that. There is a spark, and we totally make out. I mean, that is so... Compared to the
nice.
Greg Davis ones, that is quite sweet.
We totally make
we
out.
We totally make
Not
out.
Not like half.
No.
Is that how you do
that's
it?
That's how you do it. I know, it's a long time since I've made out. you know, with a stranger. Or my wife. This one I quite enjoy. Helen Keane, and Joe, you know, aware of Helen Keane?
She's got my friend.
She's an,
Do I have to have sex with her in this?
No, quite the opposite. Well, not quite the opposite. Helen Keane, it's unusual. Well, it starts in a... No, it's not. What's interesting about this guy is the level of this fantasy is what I'm trying to get at. Helen Keane and Josie Long would probably be upset when they discovered I was fucking the other one behind their back. I mean, someone who's got deeply into, like, the fantasy of, yeah, what I'm doing, I'm going to have sex
with
both.
So get us both. Get us both. Yeah. That's not enough for him. It's got to hurt us both.
You'll both find out. And it's kind of the presumption that you both go, oh, yeah, that guy, how could he treat us like that? We loved him so much. And now I found out what he was doing with... Oh, dear. Josie Long's giggle gets me going. That's just me.
Like, when you first mooted it,
yeah.
I was like, oh, this could be nice. But actually, it's quite weird.
Yeah.
But well, keep going.
Yeah, okay. I imagine that a lot of the people who write these now tune into this podcast and are furiously masturbating as their things are read. And I like that. That's one of my fantasies, is that strange stalkerish men sit at home masturbating as I speak. So I'm fully aroused. A hot summer's afternoon. See, they're all quite there. They're nice. A hot summer's afternoon with Josie Long and a Roundtree's fruit pastel lolly. That is all. Now, I like fruit pastel lollies. I mean, that might be just what it is, mightn't it? But there could be...
Read it again.
A hot summer's afternoon with Josie Long and a Roundtree's fruit pastel lolly. They are slightly phallic in shape. And also, like many men's penises, multicoloured. With, I believe, a purple end, if I remember correctly.
When I was 13 years old, I used to love your show so much that what I did was we had to do an IT project where we had to design a children's summer camp. Yeah. And I designed the children's summer camp to be themed around Fist of Fun.
That's good.
And then I made certificates on the primitive school computers that said, like, Peter Bainham congratulates you for winning the school summer camp.
Yeah.
And then it had, like, clip art pictures of people standing on podiums. And I think if I could go back now to my 13-year-old self and say, he's going to be talking about, like, fucking you with an ice lolly, and, like, looking you right in the eyes. I think I wouldn't have tried as hard.
I think it would have been inappropriate to do it when you were 13. Though I would, like, all celebrities, I would not have been convicted.
Wouldn't have held up.
Even if I had or hadn't done it. I think I've covered myself legally, though not morally. Did your teacher think you were mentally ill and created a fantasy world that she had no idea about? Because you were probably the only person who knew that show existed.
We just had loads of, like, in-jokes in the project.
Yeah.
Like, it was the club was called Camp Rod Hull. That was the club.
Yeah, okay. Unfortunately, even my own audience don't know what you're talking about. That's how bad it is.
Sad, isn't it?
Yeah.
Do more.
Do you want more, do you?
Sorry, that sounded like I was trying to be the boss.
Do you want more, do you? Do you know what you want? You want the moon on the stick. Yeah.
I'm just...
Get it? Get it.
Hello? Is that me from the past? You don't want to know what just happened because you're going to fucking freak out. You're going to fucking freak out.
This one's quite interesting. It is opening a world of weirdness. I once hugged Josie Long after a gig. Regrettably, I was too drunk to remember it. I bet it was the best hug ever.
I feel good.
Yeah, was that good?
I mean, that's lovely. That
I had someone, but yeah, okay.
But it's not the right arena for that. They could have at least said, and I was really aroused.
Yeah.
Like...
It's a mild fantasy. These are mild fantasies. This one, maybe less so. I'm not a lesbian. I don't think Josie Long is either, but I would. I think it would be really great to just pal around with her as well, having coffee, taking walks, and reading books together. It would be great. Well, I quite like that. It starts off, you think it's going to be quite steamy, and then it's just like, I'd just like to be a friend,
pal
really.
Around.
But then.
I'd love to pal around with her.
Yeah, okay, we can work that out.
Can we put it on underneath?
Like, yeah.
Okay. I'm interested.
And this is the most sexual of them. So get ready, masturbating men at home. I have dreams where I role play as a teacher student with Josie Long. I don't know which way round that is, though. Just says teacher student with Josie Long. I want to... Oh, no, I think you're the teacher. I want her to spank me hard, push me up against the desk, and then teach me discipline. What kind of teacher
I'm
would
so
do that?
Busy, I can't be... I've got a lot on.
Yeah.
God,
I think you'd have to just punish him and Richard. I think like this punishment would be not to be disciplined, because what he's asked for is wrong.
Why is that what you want? You're not going to get.
Well, there we go. That is Britcom, Dirty Britcom Confessions. You've been to, I'm quite interested in this, you've been to the Crap Comedy Festival in Oslo.
I've been twice.
Have you?
Yeah.
And it's crap with a double P.
Yeah, Krapapaparka.
That's it.
That's what it's called. I can speak Norwegian.
What is it? Do they know that's funny when they call it the Crap Comedy Festival?
But I thought it was, before the first time I went, they kept advertising it in Norwegian on Twitter, and it was like, comedians, Klapper, Josie Long, and I'd be like, why the fuck are Norwegians slagging me off? Like, what have I done? And then I went, it's good.
Is it really nice?
It's run by these two guys called Rolf and Martin, and another guy that I can't, he's got like a foreign name, so I'm not going to remember that. But they're really experimental comedians. Like one of them did this thing where he did this long mime for about 15 minutes that he was talking to this giant, right? Someone else was doing the voiceover for the giant, so it'd be in Norwegian. And then he like mimed masturbating this giant, and then he got a bucket to like collect all of the.
Yeah.
But it was. This is very blue, by the way, for me. I'm not.
It
really...
is. You've been very blue all evening. You're over. I'm slightly disgusted. Just enjoying it takes my life. A lot to disgust me.
But that's what he did. Yeah. It was really.
Did anything come out?
It was mimed. And the other one, he had half a beard for this sketch. He had a full beard, but only half a beard. So he sort of did this sort of like Victoria thing.
Yeah.
But they're all kind of. But they're all really healthy, and their posture's really good, and their clothes look really expensive, but not in a showy way. And they all, as well as being comedians, they all kind of do something really socially responsible.
Yeah.
Like, they all kind of work in local politics and stuff as well, and they're all doing PhDs. Just like, because life's too easy for
them. In Norway, doesn't everyone get a share of the oil money?
Probably.
Is that right? They've all got like 200,000 euros.
Such a great time.
Just sort of in the bank. They're allowed to use it, but it's there for them. Anyone know? Or am I thinking in the wrong place, or is it Sweden? No, we've all gone quiet. Okay, that's how it's going to be.
I don't know, but they do. I mean, they do have a really great equal society, or more equal society where it's more prosperous.
That's no fun, though, is it, as a comedian? You really want, in a way, don't you want it to be unequal so you've got something to rail against?
I'm just tired. It's been so hard for so long.
When's there going to be an International Men's Day? That's what I want to know. That's what I want to know.
I got excited because my friend said, when's there going to be a Prince, the Prince on International Men's Day? I can't remember the name of it. When's there going to be a Prince International? And then I could reply, November 19th, and be like, I'm like Richard Herring, I'm joining in.
So you did supported a comedian called Stuart Lee, one of your first...
Your best friend. And then I stole your boyfriend off you.
You would think so.
Yeah, I supported him on tour when I was 22.
Was it nice being in the car with him?
He did fart a lot.
Yeah, I've been in cars with him. Did he ever shit himself when he was in the car?
No, he was very dignified.
He did that in the car with me once. We were going to Cheltenham. We were going to perform in Cheltenham. It was him, me and Peter Bain, I think. And he didn't do it on purpose. I don't think. But
like
now.
A 3-year-old doing a protest.
Yeah, he was driving. And so,
would you not let him stop at the services or something?
I think he had to die something. You know, he's only a human being. He has occasionally has diarrhea. And he farted, but he followed through. And then he had to drive. We were only halfway to Cheltenham when that happened, so he then had to drive.
So you all just were like, we'll stay in the car. It doesn't matter that there's now human shit in it.
Yes.
You just were like, I don't want to take the 5 minutes off the time.
We had no control over it. He was driving.
But you could stop the
car. I think
we
might have been a bit late. We got to the
gig. But you're the show.
We went to the gig, and then he went to the toilet in the Cheltenham College, whatever it was. And then he took off his pants. throwing them in the bin. He hid them in one of the cisterns. They might still be there.
Be worth a fortune. Anyway.
It will be worth a lot of money if anyone goes and checks that. I can't remember which college it was, but there can't be that many colleges there. It's a higher education college.
He's really nice to me on tour.
Was he? Didn't
really...
So he never shat himself.
No.
Just, he farted though.
A bit, but not a lot.
He has like quite a serious bowel problem. So, you know, he is, you know, we shouldn't laugh at him.
He's very, and once we were doing two nights in Tunbridge Wells, and once we in the hotel drank all the whole minibar. And then the party, it was really good.
That
was good. And then once we were in Lincoln, and I was 22, just turned 22, and he was like 51 or something. We're doing it. And we did the show at the university in Lincoln, and there's this big group of boys. And this is the first, only time this ever happened to me in my life, right? It's a big group of boys. And basically what would happen is, young, good-looking boys would come up to me, and I'd be like, oh my God, this is the best thing that's ever happened to me. And they'd be like, Can you introduce me to Shirley? I'd be like, fuck you, fuck this, right? And this whole group of boys were like, will you come out dancing with us? And I was like, yeah, I would love to. And then they were like, and Stuart Lee will come as well. But he didn't come, but it was snowing. And we had a big snowball fight. Oh. And then we went to this nightclub and danced all night. And there were like loads of, we had loads of fun. And then at the end, there was like me and this guy. And I was like, you should just come back to the hotel with me, right?
Yeah.
And we were staying in Christian rented accommodation. Because Stuart found all these like amazing odd places to stay around the country. It was really exciting. We were staying in these sort of, I think there was like us and monks staying there in Lincoln Cathedral.
Yeah.
And it was snowing. And me and this guy walked up to the top of... by Lincoln Cathedral, and we were sat in the snow, and it was so quiet, you could hear the snow just like, and we were chatting, it was super romantic, and I was like, this is an incredible night, like, I've been taken out in the town by all these guys, this beautiful country, and I was like, you should come to my room, and he's like, yeah, cool. So then we sat in my room, like, having hot chocolate, because I'm a twee cunt, and then we were like, and then I was like, and then he just suddenly was like, I have to go to work now, I have to go to work tomorrow, I'm leaving, and I was like, how have I fucked this up? Like, this is the coolest thing. And then he left. And the next day, after 1 hour sleep, we had to drive to Derbyshire. And Stuart was like, you had a boy in the Christian accommodation. And I was like, I didn't even fucking kiss him. Nothing happened. We're just drunk. Of course you didn't kiss him. And then we did this gig in Derbyshire. And we went to a stone circle. So he loves him with that. Yeah, we went to a stone circle. It was really brilliant.
What a prick. Seriously, grow up.
We met all these eco-warriors.
Yeah, of course you did.
Camping out.
Yeah.
It's a brilliant day out. And also I did my favourite trick, which is when you're walking along in the snow and then you keep deliberately falling over and pretending there's something wrong with you, which is hilarious. And then we had this gig in Derbyshire where I died so fucking hard that I ruined the gig for him. Oh, and there was another time that I died, and he was really proud of me because I died so hard, and then someone at the back who didn't know who Stuart was like, this is as bad as Ted Chippington. And Stuart was like, fucking yeah! so that's, it was brilliant. He treated me really, really kindly and gave me loads of good advice. And
did he ever try and get, when you were asleep, wait, it's not what you think it's going to be, it's what you think it's going to be. Did he ever bring out a ventriloquist dummy of any kind? And just say he was just trying to cheer you up? Yeah. Gotta go.
What can you do? What can you
do? He's paying your wages.
He's driving us around. We're in a stone circle in the middle of nowhere. I'm trying to think. Nothing else happened.
See, I when I'm on tour, I just go to the hotel and like the Travel Lodge or the Premier Inn, stay in there. If I've got time, I just sit in there.
Do you have a support act with you?
No.
Why not?
Because fuck you. Fuck you, young kids. I'm not going to train you up so you become better than me and take my job. Also, I don't earn enough money to pay anyone else, but my shows are all like 90 minutes long, so I don't need... You know,
my show's 90
I don't
minutes
need,
long.
So I don't need someone to come along and
some
help me out.
Sometimes I have two support acts.
Do you?
Just to give people value for money.
I like the loneliness of being on the road, just sitting in a travel lodge with a bogey on the shower curtain.
Oh, that's a happy life, isn't it?
Just kind of weeping, drinking wine on my own. Wish of thinking how things could have been.
I do a lot of just going swimming.
Do you?
In the sea or whatever. Or find, like, wherever you go to the gig, you find a lake or something. And you
Stu used to go climbing up mountains and stuff on tour.
Yeah.
Fuck that. hard enough doing the gig and then getting drunk and then trying to get off with girls and failing to do that and then having a curry.
Without, right, when she slotted all that in,
without
it,
having
it
to climb
up
a mountain in the middle of it all. Well, you're lucky he didn't shit in the car. If anyone finds, that's the kind of, I'm just saying, that is the kind of thing he does. You got something onto Fist of Fun, I saw.
I did?
Yeah.
Did you remember?
No, I read some. I read an interview where you talked about...
Were you just Googling Fist of Fun?
No, I was Googling you.
Why?
Because I'm talking to you now. I think it's polite to know a little bit of something about you, oh, so right, I can ask a question.
But you were Googling like Josie Long, Fist of Fun.
No, it was Josie Long, and then one of the interviews...
Josie Long shit, there's a lot.
They said, obviously, you must have watched a lot of Richard Herring when you're younger, because you're really funny, and you're exactly the same as him. So,
oh, I got a heckle in Newcastle.
Did you?
I was doing a tour, and there was this guy who thought himself to be incredibly fey and brilliant, and yeah, he was a cunt. And I was... It was about 10 minutes in, and I said something about Kurt Vonnegut, and he went, oh. And I went, you don't like Kurt Vonnegut? And then he was like, oh, I do. And I was like, okay, cool, what's wrong? And he's like, you got the book wrong. And I was like, mate, I've done this like 100 times. I've definitely fact-checked it. Like, he's like, oh, okay, well, as you were. And that's my least favourite thing that hecklers do when they go, as you were. As if you're a fucking chambermaid or something. Yeah. And then he went, as you were. And then he went, just keep going, keep ripping off Richard Herring. And I was like, oh, fuck.
Yeah.
I
send him to a lot
of
gigs.
He's getting round.
It's where I spend most of my money. That's why I can't afford a sport act. Because that guy, he's travelling around. Oh, yeah. He likes staying in posh hotels.
You can imagine. Send his expenses.
I've got the new title of the
as
book.
As you were.
I could see from the way he said Vonnegut that you don't know how to spell it. But you sent in a millet. Was this in the TV show or the radio show?
A TV show. I'm
yeah,
too young for the radio show.
Not one of the real proper fans.
Too young for the radio show. Okay.
You're too young for the TV show. you sent in a Millennium Dome.
I did.
Oh, that's good.
I did. I used to try every week to get stuff in. Yeah. There's nothing to do in Orpington. And I used to try every week to get stuff.
Orpington. Some people come from Orpington.
Thank you. What school did you go to?
Romanswood.
Did you?
Romanswood.
It's all boys.
Is it?
Anyway, there's like, I used to send you one every, and the one that I got in was the Millennium Dome. You had to say what was going to be in the Millennium Dome. And it was, mine was a Q-shaped map of Lewisham for no reason. It was the shape of Q. And it was like, the Q map of Lewisham featuring facts about Lewisham. Like, Lewisham is near St. John's. And then, I was like 13 or something. And then there was like a googly-eyed version of Tony Blair that you could punch.
No
the
memory.
Satire.
No memory of any of that.
It was
that
on yellow paper. Do you remember that?
No, I don't even remember doing that feature. I don't really remember anything about the show. Doing it feels like a different. When I look at it, it feels like who's that bloke in the hole?
Really?
It's me. Yeah, it doesn't. I can barely remember doing it.
That's sad.
Yeah. I was working hard writing it all whilst you went out and got drunk. So. there we go.
It's not what he said on tour.
No. It's not what he says in his book that ignores everything I did. I got heckled last. I don't usually get heckled, but I got heckled because I was taking the pit. I was in Birmingham last night. And then I go, I've been doing this job for 25 years. I'm in some shitty club in Birmingham. They didn't like that for some reason. And usually it goes quite well. I thought it would go especially well in Birmingham. And the bloke said, yeah, you're not doing as well as Stuart Lee. And I said, yeah, no, I'm not. But, you know, it's like, that's ridiculous. Why they got him, he's got his own TV show. That's like someone's gone, hey, you know, Schnorbitz is really good. Let's give him his own TV show. They've chosen the wrong one. They can't put the funny one in with his own TV show. Not the other one. It doesn't make sense. So, I'll ask you some emergency questions. They're not going to be as rude as the one I asked you backstage, which led to some bizarre places. Incidentally, if you give £1 a month via the Go Faster Strike site, you will get extras on extra bits of interview that you can't get anywhere else. And that interview will be one of those things that only about...
I feel bad because you got kind of, like, sickened by me being dirty, and so yeah. I sort of stopped myself, and I felt like I could have just... finished off what I was going to say, but I didn't.
It's worth £1 a month just to find out what that is. Would you rather have a hand made out of ham,
Yes.
Or an armpit that dispenses sun cream.
I'd rather have a hand made out of hand.
Would you?
Yeah.
Straight in, you don't need any
sun cream. Like what? Oh, bro, you can't eat that.
You can't eat it. No.
Like, I already eat my fingernails.
Yeah, I do.
And
as
my
well.
Fingers as well, and I sort of consider it to be a pleasure.
How
treat.
Far down the finger will you go? The
I'll
human
go as
finger
far as the cuticle.
Will you?
But then, yeah, I'll go as far as the. But if it went further.
So you eat a bit of the. Well, doesn't that really hurt if you eat the cuticle?
Yeah, sometimes it's kind of nice.
Yeah, the other week, as I showed, I had this finger. It's better now if anyone was worried about it. I got all pus in my cuticle. Do you remember, have you ever had that? And,
no.
then, and then it gets puffs up and then you can you can squeeze it and it all comes out.
How did you get it?
How did I...
How did it come about?
I don't know. I just,
what were you touching?
Nothing. No, I wasn't touching it. That's my left hand. I don't use that. For those purposes. So you'd rather... Because the sun cream, you could, you know...
And also, like, if you had a hand made out of ham, that's the talking point.
So is an armpit that dispenses sun cream, to be honest.
It is, but it's like a boring talking
it's
point.
It's very... How dare you? How
also,
dare you come
how
here?
Does it dispense it? Like a nipple or like a plastic nozzle?
There's like a... I mean, it's not plastic, because you're a human being. It's ridiculous. There would be some kind of nozzle there that you squirt it and it would then come out.
These are my additional questions. Is the...
Maybe you should have asked these before you jumped in with, I want a hand.
No, mate, don't give a shit, mate. Not going to change my mind. Right? Is the sun cream inside your body?
Yeah.
Or is it in like a pouch as part of your body?
It's inside your body. It's in your armpit.
What is it doing to the rest of my body?
Nothing. It's in a... You know, it's sealed. It's hermetically sealed within...
How does my body produce it?
From a gland...
Okay, that makes sense. I appreciate the science of that.
Good.
Right. If I were trying to get it out,
yeah.
Would I need to manually touch it? Or would I just have to think and it would squirt out?
I think the technology would change. So to begin with, it would just squirt out. But then eventually there would be...
But that's insane. After how long?
That technology
isn't
here yet.
Because I'd be used to it to begin with. And then it would all change.
Yeah. But then you'd be able to think it.
Ham hand.
Then I think eventually you'd be able to think it, and then it would just appear in your hand like time, like a, it would, you know, like beam into your hand, eventually.
Well, and then what would happen to the armpit? Would it grow over?
Yeah.
What would happen?
I guess it would.
What would happen to what was? Would there be leftover sun cream stuck in my body that couldn't come out of the armpit?
Well, it could beam out. Whenever you needed it, so it would be there ready, waiting. It would be more convenient.
I have
in many
no
ways
questions about
nozzle.
The ham hand. The ham hand, I've just gone, great, brilliant.
Gone for the ham hand. If you had to choose between...
Do you mind that I'm asking a lot of questions?
No, that's what, that's the point.
I could talk for a long time about them.
I want you to ask a lot of questions.
Okay.
Would you rather have... I don't know why I'm reading this, because it's not even on this piece of paper. And B, I know what it is. Would you rather have a tit?
Can you do like this?
Would you rather have... My emergency questions get worse right at the end. Did you go travelling as a teenager? That's my new emergency question. I don't want any stories. I just want yes or no.
No.
Okay. Would you rather have a tit that dispenses talcum powder? That's right, isn't it? Yes. And do you know where talcum powder comes from?
I do not. Please tell
it's
me.
It's mined, apparently. But not here. In this case, it would just be... There'd be a gland in your body that would create it. You might have to send miners in occasionally. If there was a clog, they would go... Little tiny miners, like in...
Inner Space.
Well, I was going to think of an older film than you, The Fantastic Voyage.
Okay.
With Raquel Welsh. No, there's a real generation divide. I forgot that right. It is The Fantastic Voyage. I'm looking for an old person. Yes. Raquel Welsh. She gets like all antibodies on her and they have to pull them off her. Best thing that happened in my childhood. That's almost as good as Janet Ellis being Nell Gwynn and doing oranges. It's up there, top three. Some old men laughing at the back. Would you rather have a tit that dispensed talcum powder or a finger that could travel through time?
The finger that could travel
What would
through
you
time?
Do with the finger that could travel through time? It's just your finger.
I don't even care. That's so amazing.
It is.
Send
what
it
would
to the future.
You could
and
go
I
the
would
future.
Just bid it farewell. I'd be like, you bloody go for it. I can't
It would still be attached to you. You can't. It's not going away.
Hang on.
You go there. It'd be the. Imagine this. Imagine this is the future. That's the hole.
From your perspective. So it's like a glory hole.
It is like a glory hole. And, you know, that is the next question. But I build up to it gradually, firstly with the finger, see how that goes. This is just a dating tip. That would go through flip. From your perspective, you can't see that, can you? You don't know where that finger, it could be doing anything, it could be dizzying anything.
I can only travel forwards into the future in the exact physical space where I am.
No, you can travel in time and space, obviously.
Wait. Right.
So what? Your finger would go through, that's a wormhole, goes through. You say, I wanted to go to 2748, January the 3rd, the Leicester Square Theatre.
So hang on, the finger's travelling anywhere, beyond the wormhole is anywhere physically.
Yeah.
But I'm still rooted.
You're still here, you're still attached to your finger. You can look through and go, oh yeah.
Hang on, I can look through?
You can look through there.
Well, why do I have to put my finger through? I'll just look through.
Because the finger, you can't look through unless the finger's in there. That is why. Well, it's like, it's difficult to explain. We haven't really had time to explain the mechanics of the time travel thing. But it's like, it's sort of like a web thing, you know, like a film.
A spider's web.
Like a film. You put your finger in and then it would...
Film? What do you mean, like a cling film?
Yeah, like cling film, but you put your finger in, but it's opaque. Until...
What happens if...
Yeah.
I go back in time.
Yeah.
And I touch one of my grandparents.
Yeah. All right. Well, it depends where you touch them. You could put your finger through as your granddad was ejaculating.
Oh.
And hold up and stuff up his herring's eye, as I like to call it, the meatus, and then stop your parents being born. They could back up. Imagine your granddad. What we do is just imagine your granddad about to ejaculate.
You know one of the breasts is talcum powder.
Yeah.
Does anyone ever choose that? Because that's shit.
Yeah, Jenny and Claire chose it.
Why?
Because you know she's likes using uses a lot of talcum powder.
You wouldn't be able to feed your children if you had a baby.
Well, wouldn't you? Because you could sell
talcum powder. Yeah, but.
Think of all the savings. No one's having to mine that anymore. All the equipment that's gone.
Can you dispense as much talcum powder as
exactly.
you want?
Exactly.
So you could become the world supplier of talcum powder.
And you could just go, if you saw people going to Starbucks toilet changing a nappy, you could just knock on the door and go, think you might need this. You could help people. You're not helping anyone going through time touching your granddad's urethra, are you? Like you want to.
You could go... You could go back in time and do something good with your finger.
Yeah, you could, yeah. What would that be?
You could kill Hitler.
You couldn't.
You could stab him in the eye.
You could
straight into his head.
You could hurt his eye.
Kill him.
What, push him through?
Yeah.
Would you be prepared to do that? Would you?
Yeah.
At what point would
you not?
Well, at what point?
You're saying that if you had those powers, you wouldn't kill Hitler.
Push him, Hitler's eye. Hey, Hitler.
Because you're too squeamish.
Hitler could move away. He'd see the finger go, fuck. What's that? And he would move. He wouldn't just stand there.
No, but he wouldn't know what was happening.
You're saying you'd get your finger in Hitler's forehead, push him against a wall so that he couldn't move anywhere, then move the hand down.
No.
I think even then Hitler's going, oi!
This is what I do.
Free.
Do you want to know what I do?
Got the hand free to push.
Do you know what I do?
Let
me tell you what I do.
No, I don't want to. I'm pushing me.
This is what I do.
Yeah.
Wait till he's asleep.
Yeah.
Right? I feel very giggly today. And I think it's because he did all this stuff about people talking about having sex with me. And it really, like, it's weird.
It was
but
weird,
like,
I'm sorry.
Right. No, it was always. It's, right, so.
Have I retrospectively groomed you by
do you remember
coming
when
into your
I did a show in the same venue as you when I was 19 years old.
Yeah, let's not talk about that on film. No,
but what, you had a really big bar of chocolate and you said you can have as much of that as you want. And I was like, he really is a nice guy, isn't he?
Yeah.
And then Justin Morehouse, who's a comedian from Manchester that I was doing the show with, ate all of the chocolate and said, just say it was you. I was like, you fucking dick. This good man has offered us this bounty. So what I do is Hitler's asleep and I would get the wormhole to be right on his face.
Yeah.
And then I would just put the tip of my finger in so I could look, because I can't look unless my finger's in the gauze. And then I'd be like, straight in
the I don't think it would kill him.
That'd do the other one.
I don't think it did kill him, because he lived. At what point would you kill Hitler? Because, you know, he's already committed. Would you do it before he did it?
1926.
Yeah, but then, you know, I had Stephen Fry on here talking about this very same thing. Just go and look at that. So, okay. We'll ask a non-emergency question now. This question that I am going to ask is this. It's just all I've done is written out loads of stuff from the Dirty Britcom confessions that it's hard to wade through. You've done lots of Edinburgh shows. You've been nominated for the Comedy Award 3 times running.
Yeah.
And not won it.
No, never.
Did you win the Best Newcomer?
Yes.
That's all right, isn't it?
Yes, yeah, so I got. I you know, yeah. It didn't matter. It's but just you 10 grand. It was just buying a house.
No, it's just 10 grand. Did you go and just spend it on a holiday?
Got Hawaii for this month. Yeah, that's you what could I do.
Probably for 2 days.
I don't know. It was a weird thing, because the first time it happened, I didn't expect it to happen at all, and that was really exciting. And then every subsequent year, it just got more and more frightening and stressful. But now it just feels lovely, and it feels like, oh, cool, I've done that, and no one can take that away from me. And now, because there are still people who take offence to my existence and who think I'm shit and don't know what I'm doing, so it's quite nice when people are really rude to me online to take a photo of all my awards and send it to them and be like, oh, shall I give these back? Which I know is like a cunty thing to do, but...
Well, it's quite a cunty thing to get in touch with someone to tell them that you don't think they're any good. That's more cunty, I would say. So they deserve that.
It balances out.
I think it balances out. I think it does.
But yeah, it's nice. It's really cool.
Does it get to you if people don't like you? Because if you're a good comedian, people aren't going to... Not everyone's going to like you. I don't think... Even if you're a bad comedian, not everyone's going to like you.
No, but you're really bad.
If you're doing something interesting, not everyone's going to like it. So some people not liking it surely is a sign that
I really
you're
do
doing...
like the idea that I might be doing something all right. Like, yeah. I really love what I do, and I'm obsessed with it, and I feel like I want to do it my whole life, and I love the fact that it's always changing what I want to do, and I also love the fact that I've been doing it for so long in my life, like, more of my life than I've not, like, since I was, like, 14, 15... Since basically I stopped watching your stupid fucking show. No, I've been doing it so long that, like, I genuinely feel like it's how I understand the world and how I, like, process my emotions, all this shit like that. Like, it just is such a big part of what I want to do with my life. That, like, especially now, I just feel like I've been doing it so long, I'm like, oh, I just don't care if you hate it. Like, we'll all be fine. And also I, like, learned this thing, like, when I first started, I used to get lots of reviews that were basically like, please give up now. Please give up now. And at the time, I was so freaked out. And also, like, people online would be like, she's such a cunt. Oh, she should be killed, right? And then I realised the other, like, quite recently, I was like, oh, I've sort of been able to do everything I've wanted to do, more or less. And it didn't stop me from doing it. I thought it would kind of destroy any hope I had for a career, but kind of didn't make a blind bit of difference. So now I just feel like, oh, well, anyone can say anything. It doesn't matter at all.
Well, Stuart had a review in 1999 where, you know, we'd been up for a few years and he was doing his stand-up and doing essentially the same thing he does now, to be honest. Actually, some of the same routines that everyone lauds now. And someone said...
I don't think that's fair. He's written loads of stuff. It's been good.
No, he's
written
loads of stuff, but he was... I'm honestly saying he was doing actually some of the things that people now journalists say are amazing. Some of the same things.
Yeah.
And the same basic... You know, the same...
Yeah.
You know, he does the same basic thing every thing, right? So, he was doing that, just repeating the same thing over and over again, as if anyone would find that funny. and like someone reviewed saying, why doesn't Stuart Lee just fuck off and never come back to Edinburgh? So that was, and so he was not, he wasn't at all critically acclaimed, really. He's a lot, you know, his stand-up shows got really nasty reviews early
but
on,
even
and now
his
he never does.
Recent one, no, even his recent ones, he'll still
well,
get
snarky.
Not
from the press, though. That's, I think it's kind of different when it's from the press, but what I'm saying is, you know, people don't know fuck all, basically, is what, you know, he was clearly good then, and people were still being nasty to him then.
But also, I just think I love it too much, so I don't really give a fuck, and, like, I think I'm quite spoilt, because when I actually do go and do my own shows, I really like meeting people that come, because quite often there's, like, really interesting, creative people come to my shows, and I feel really... And like, I love going around the country and knowing that I've got those friends in that place because they started coming and I've done 6 tours or whatever, so I know them all. Yeah. I don't know, just feels really lucky that there are people who seem to understand what I want to do or, like, trusting enough for that shit. And
yeah. Well, it's, good. You know, it's an amazing thing to get to as a comedian because it is quite difficult to get enough people to like you to be able to tour.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that is...
But then I'm only talking between, like, 20 and 300 people. It's not, like... No. Massive. I was thinking about that today because somebody was talking about people doing arenas and I was like, oh yeah, like 1,000 people. And then they were like 10,000 people. And I think I hadn't really thought about that. I was like, what, one fucking person? That's a rip-off. If there's just one person on the stage, just 20,000 of you, you wouldn't even get a chance to murder them. If you all rush the stage to murder them, you wouldn't even get to touch them.
I think that's why most people are going to comedy gigs. I think you'd get a chance. If you thought, I'm going to rush the stage and kill Michael McIntyre, I reckon you could probably do it.
I did a gig.
Don't do it, though. He's nice. He's all right.
I did a gig in Hay on Wye, and only 15 people came. If they wanted to kill me, they'd each get a good go at it.
They could. They could all collude. Yeah, if 10,000 people wanted to kill Michael McIntyre, they'd A, have to pay £50 to £100. I think that would put them off.
£8.
They go, I'll just wait till he's out the back, and I'll just kill him in the car park. If you're going to... I hope he doesn't get murdered between now and this going out. If he gets murdered after this has gone out, well, that's probably worse, actually, isn't it? Then it looks like I've sort of Manchurian candidated. Kill Michael McIntyre. I want to get him on as a guest on here. Don't kill him until he's been a guest on this show. Then you can do what you like. it's insane. So, like, if you go and see people at the O2, then...
I've never been to see comedy like that.
Don't bother.
What's the point? Anyway.
There is no point. Even sitting like on the near the back of the floor bit of the O2 is too far away to sit in. So you might as well just get a DVD and of the performance and then put it a long way away and watch it from there.
No, put it a long way away and then put an auxiliary screen there and watch it just at the side the whole time like that.
That would be the best thing to do. So that's sort of in the same area that I am touring. It's a lovely place to be where you're going around the country, people are paying to see you and you can make a living from it. So it is.
It's amazing.
That is enough in itself.
And also, I kind of like internet abuse now because I've had so much of it that I just kind of like, I try new techniques on it and see which one makes me feel the best.
Yeah. What are your favourite techniques?
Oh, my favourite new one is just typing unsubscribe. So if someone like tweets me something like cunty, I'll just type unsubscribe. And the other day this guy tweeted me, "Are women funny?" And I tweeted unsubscribe. And then he went, it's a tweet, it's not an email. And I was like, you fucking got it, mate. Do that. Or sometimes I'm like, you have a crush on me. And they hate that. They fucking hate it. Or I say like, I know you are, but what am I?
That's quite good.
Yeah.
Are women funny though? That's the
No. Really disappointing.
Yeah.
That's what we like.
I've never found a single woman funny at any point in my life. Which I think may speak more about me. Not a single person has made me laugh who has not got a penis. And I've checked.
Do you know what's been
I've
really
checked every when someone's made me laugh, I've said, excuse me.
Could you just
thank God.
There's this thing recently that started happening where really earnest, sweet people who are doing their degree will write an email to like my agent or send me a tweet or something saying, I'm writing a thesis about women in comedy, please can I interview you? And I have to be like, oh, I'm ill, I'm busy. And I feel really guilty, but I'm just like, if I have to talk about it anymore, I'm just going to start like punching myself in the face and being like, is this what you want? You know, because it's...
That'd be quite good for our podcast. So I might keep pushing it.
I'll do that for you.
Thank you. You do writing. You've written on Skins, which is not a show I've watched because, you know, I'm very old. Though I watch Hollyoaks. I think it's just the convenience of having that on an actual terrestrial channel.
Skins was on Channel 4.
Was it?
I thought it was on E4. It moved to Channel 4 because it was so successful.
It was on too late for me, really. I like to be in bed by whatever time that is.
It's a really brilliant show.
Yeah. No, I've heard.
Deal with that, huh? That's really brilliant. Yeah. And also, what's really exciting is this guy called Edward Bond did the costumes for the first... I think did it for all of it, but specifically with the first series. Like, before it happened, and then after it happened... you could see the difference in the way that 17-year-olds were dressing, and it was because of this one guy and how he chose to dress these kids. It like had this massive influence on how kids dressed, and I was sort of blown away by that. I was like, that's incredible. You've had this massive influence on youth culture and stuff like that. It's pretty good.
And what? So were you writing whole episodes of that?
No, I never got as far because I'm really bad at writing drama. Like what? Because one of the two creators of it is this man Brian Elsley, who's this incredible TV writer, and he has written like everything good in the past, and they all. They were so generous that they would get all these young writers together in the writer's room and just be really, like, giving you advice on how to write and giving you, like, mentoring, and it was just amazing. And so I, like, wrote little short films for them, and they were always, like, trying to help me to get to a position to write a full episode, and I would always, like, either fuck off to Australia for 3 months, mm-hmm. which is my favourite thing to do, or try and do it, but I just, like, don't really understand writing drama because I just kind of don't want anything bad to happen to any of the characters. So, like, my dream episode would be they all have a party and they have a great time at the end, and then they all take lanterns to the beach because that would look pretty.
Yeah, well, that's what... Danny Baker's wife would watch. Yeah, would watch that.
And but I get that totally. I find it really hard to write drama, and so when I'll come in and they'll be like, "Okay, so this character that everyone loves is going to die," I'll be like, "What the fuck, mate? It's not going to fucking happen." But I was more sort of.
Were they coming here? You know, it's pretend. It's pretend.
It's not pretend. I've met them all. But they're really generous and kind to me, and like I learnt so much from it, and I got to meet loads of writers. Like, there's this guy Jack Thorne who wrote on Skins, and he wrote This Is England. 86 and 88, and he writes amazing. He's incredible, and like Jamie Britton, who was one of the co-creators, is like this amazing writer, and like
yeah.
There's like, and also I know famous people because of it, and so like when Dev Patel was in Slumdog Millionaire, I knew him, and every time I did went anywhere, like in cabs, I'd be like, get in the cab, and they'd be like, where to, and I'd be like, seen that film Slumdog Millionaire? I actually know that guy, and I'd just dine out on it for like months and months.
I met him on Mark Kermode and Simon Mayo's Christmas quiz that year, but I hadn't seen Slumdog Millionaire. I don't think it had come out yet, but they'd seen it, but I hadn't seen it, so it was just some bloke, you know, some young kid.
He's really
nice.
Funny.
He was very nice, yeah.
And they were all really funny, like yeah. Joe Dempsey was on it.
Yeah.
He's amazing.
And really what's his face from About a Boy?
Nick Holt. Nick Holt's really cool.
And who's
he goes out with Jennifer Lawrence. Did you even know that?
Out with Jennifer Lawrence.
I just found that out at the Oscars.
Yeah. I just found it out at the Oscars. He auditioned for You Could Choose Your Friends, which was the last thing I wrote for ITV, playing like the one of my nephews, basically. But he got the part, but he didn't want to do it.
Didn't want to take it.
No, it wasn't a very big part, and he just got Skins. But he's in About a Boy. Remember him in About a Boy? Killing Me Softly. Oh. He grew, and now he's diddling Jennifer Lawrence.
I was so excited, and then I was like, oh, I'll text him. And then I was like, I probably don't have his number anymore.
Oh, that's why she keeps falling over. So, in my imagination. So you did start very young, though. You were like a tiny teenager. You were 14 when you started doing stand-up.
Yeah.
So how did that start? Because that's a ridiculously young age to become a stand-up. What were you doing?
I was really obsessed with comedy when I was a little child, and I just loved it, and I also really loved performing. It was really precocious and annoying. And then there was a art centre that doesn't exist anymore in Beckenham, which is quite near where I grew up in Orpington, and there were stand-up comedy courses, and my mum for my 14th birthday got me in place on this course, like a precocious little dick. And it was run by this guy who was really great and really looked after me for like years, was like my mentor and my like surrogate parent figure. And I always thought he was really wise because he always like had this really like slowness to him and really like pensive. He was like really stoned the whole time, like, fucking wasted. And I just didn't know when I was 14, so he'd be like, you need to think about who you are. And I'd be like, this guy's incredible. And he was like 27 and I was like 14. And there was loads of people who are now professional comedians did it and stuff. And I used to just go to that, and it was like me and sort of quite odd, unusual group of people doing it. And
but you got an agent and stuff early on.
Yeah.
So you were gigging around, did you do Edinburgh and things like that?
No, I sort of didn't gig that much because I was at school. I sort of would gig sort of once every couple of weeks, and I didn't really understand the difference between good gigs and bad gigs. So it was like, it was all just like exciting London new life to me. Yeah. So like I'd be gigging in front of two people underneath a pub or like above a pub, and then I'd be gigging at something really important in front of 800 people and be like, fuck it all up just the same and stuff. But it was kind of all a bit weird because like I did 16 gigs and then I'd won this BBC New Comedy Awards and I think I just didn't really know what I was getting into. And I was doing So You Think You're Funny. The final of So You Think You're Funny that I was in was me, Russell Howard, Andy Zaltzman, Jimmy Carr. There's like 9 people. There's more than that. They're all famous now. They're all really rich and famous. I think maybe there's... Oh, David O'Doherty.
Right.
And like some other ones.
And who won?
David, and I come second.
Oh.
And
so that means you're better than Jimmy Carr.
And yes, much more successful than him. But that's funny to think that like Jimmy Carr and Russell Howard play to like 10,000 people a night.
It is. Imagine what my career is like.
But I don't think I really appreciated what I was getting into before that stuff. And it all kind of happened really quickly out of the blue. And then I just sort of freaked out and I had to do my A-levels. And so I sort of was like doing that a bit. And then I really, really wanted to go to university and had this dream about going to like Oxford and being in the review. But I think I didn't know enough because I sort of thought it was the footlights as well. Nice. And then when I got there, I was like, oh no, this is the shit one. and we did the Oxford review and I was there and we got like really badly slated and did really badly. But I sort of didn't do that much comedy when I was at Oxford because I've only just got over putting myself down all the time. So I used to ring people and be like, will you have me on at your club? I'm really shit. And they'd be like, no. And I was sort of too scared to put gigs and stuff. And so I used to run stuff. When I was at uni, I ran loads of comedy clubs and we did loads of really fun, anarchic shit that we could get away with. And like, we just got thrown out of venue after venue. So we went round to all the different colleges at Oxford, burning our bridges with them by like insulting the dean or ordering pizza for 300 people or like smashing all the tables. And it was good.
Then, like in the Bullington Club rather than doing
comedy. Like the Bullington Club,
have you in the Bullington Club? David Cameron came in and went, I can't believe it.
And I was like, fuck you, granddad.
But, I had a really good question for you then. I'm quite tired.
Sorry.
It's my fault. It's completely my fault.
But I always feel like with stand-up, I've been doing it so long, I really wish I was a lot better by now because it's really annoying.
It takes... I think that you go in these leaps and bounds and then you get to a plateau and then you kind of think, oh, I kind of know what I'm doing, and then you realise you didn't. I think the problem is you start off thinking, oh, I'm great at this, I'm really brilliant, and then you slowly realise... The rest of your life is slowly realising you're not as good as you thought you were. And that by getting, you know, because you're acquiring different skills all the time. So you've gone from into a kind of more political arena with your stand-up, would you say?
I did.
It started out being that kind of, you know, I mean, it's always called whimsy, which I think is a horrible word for it. But it's that kind of, I mean, but it's about doing things. Well, that's what I was going to talk about. It was like you've been described as the London Lena Dunham.
This kind of just makes me feel crushed because I'm like, oh, she's written like this incredible film and made it and made this incredible TV series.
Well, you've written
and then I'm
films
like, oh, I've got a thing I've photocopied. Yeah, I've done great. Well done.
You've got cartoons in The Guardian. It's almost as good. But I can say, I actually think there's an edge to her stuff, and especially the later stuff that I don't really like. They're just horrible people. I think in Girls, well, the third series.
I think she's just really brave. I can't wait.
I just think they're just too. I don't care about them anymore. I like the first two series, but they're just too unpleasant. So I don't really.
God, I really wish I'd seen it.
I'm glad that they when they have things go wrong for them, and also every time the bloke comes in, I just go, outer space, which is quite a niche reference, as it turns out.
But what I liked about the end of the second series,
yeah,
which I'm sort of spoiling if you've not seen it, is that she makes all these decisions that you don't want her to make, and she does everything wrong, but that's how they end it. They're like, and they pretend like it's this big romantic ending, and actually they're like, no, mate, fuck's sake. And I thought that was so brave, that it was that dissonance of it.
Yeah, I agree, and I really like it. But I just think there's loads of stuff in comedy that's about nastiness now and about people, oh, look at these people, aren't they awful? And we're meant to be laughing about how awful they are. But I just don't think anyone is that awful. And also, why not do something
that has a bit of kindness and heart?
Well, it's nice, the way someone's nice. And that's why I don't think it's a fair, because I think your stuff is more about celebrating life. And
oh, thank
then
you.
Not,
I do try and do
and
that.
And not, you know, not in a... In a great way. So there's still, you're still making points and still pointing stuff out, but it's not as I think just a lot of comedy just seems to be about, oh, look at this awful character, aren't they terrible and not self-aware of how bad they are? I just don't think people are that unself-aware generally, you know. So that seems to me have become like a trope now within, especially kind of sitcoms and things. So your stuff seems to be, to me, and the film, the little bit of your film I've seen and the ideas I've got from it, are that it's about sort of celebrating life and, you know, and dealing with the stuff that gets thrown at you.
Yeah, is I suppose that I would definitely say, like, the sort of things that I write about are trying to be about how to stay optimistic and try, like, I think the way that I've always tried to write shows is, like, what do I really care about? What am I trying to learn? What am I trying to do to make myself better? And then, like, talk about that.
Yeah. But that's kind of, you know, it does hark back a little bit to what Danny was talking about, you know, comedy can be just about joyously celebrating life rather than having to feel miserable about stuff.
The first show I ever wrote, I was like, I'm going to try really hard to make this totally positive and just be about things that I like and try and write jokes around it.
Yeah.
And that's the one that got me the most internet hatred. That's the one where people are like, this cunt should be raped in the eyes.
That's where you're doing something right, though. That's what interests me about that whole basically that international man's day thing. It comes from a place within.
It's so benign, and then people are like, stamp it out.
Well, it's about, you know, Caroline Credo Perez, if I've got her name right, who put a woman on a banknote, and therefore that's what people get angry about. You know, that they're furious with her for doing a campaign to put a woman on a banknote. People have got this built up kind of anger, which I think is the problem they've got a prejudice and they can't even see they've got a prejudice and they're not even prepared to look at their, you know, if you decide women aren't funny or there is no International Men's Day, so I'm not going to Google it and find out there is. You've just decided something is true. And if you've decided anyone's not funny, if you decide I don't like this kind of comedy, that's not then going to make you laugh, is it? Because you're going to sit there going, told you it wasn't funny.
I want to get to a stage where I'm confident enough on stage that if I see that happening, I can get off the stage and just fucking hug them and, like, just be like, we'll be all right. We're going to get through this. It doesn't matter that much.
Yeah.
And pep them up.
Yeah.
But I'm not there.
It doesn't. They probably wouldn't work. Like, the human content might be enough for these people.
It might just unlock something. But, yeah.
See, it's kind of interesting. I think there's a lot of comedy about a bad comedy. That's what I was thinking. A lot of people about comedy about bad people, and then actually the challenge I think is to create.
Right,
and I've been, you know, I'm guilty of it as anyone of both those bad things. But I don't like that. So
I like stuff
write
that
something
is about,
that is.
I like stuff that's about enthusiasm. I like stuff that's about play and that's all about, like, in jokes or people making up in jokes and games and stuff like that. And my favourite sort of stand up is stuff that really surprises me and feels really delightful and exciting. So that's the sort of thing that I want to try and make. But then it's been weird, like the last 3 years I wrote shows that were all about how angry and upset I was at what the government is doing and trying to stay optimistic and trying to sort of still try and be a happy person, but talking about that going on. But now I think I'm just going to write a show about, like, love or something.
Yeah.
Fuck them over. One step ahead and then they won't know and then fucking come back.
And
hope I'm not too boring. I'm really sorry.
I think it's all right.
Okay.
I thought you were positive now. Sorry, I'm British.
No. Oh, yeah, dude. I'm trying to be really, like, confident about myself. But then do you find that because you're a stand-up, then you're too assertive sometimes?
No, I'm very insecure. This audience of this, I'll talk about them. They can't hear us now. This is just between the two of us. But it's kind of a really weird gig, this, because sometimes the audience go very quiet and it's not always a bad thing. Sometimes it is, though. But I think this one's all right. But I think what's weird about it is because we do so much talking in a space of 3 hours, there's got to be a bit where if they're actually quiet, that's better than them going. So I think, I may be wrong, that is they're interested. We'll find out on Twitter later on and go, fucking Josie Long, what a cunt.
But then I'll just be like, unsubscribe. And then I'll be like, you feel so good about myself. Yeah. I was like, 10 steps ahead of you, prick. How are you going to come back to that, mate? You can't, mate, because it's flawless, mate. And then I blocked them anyway, so I was like, why don't you fucking see it, cunt? Do what you want, mate. And it's better than not replying. Because I was like, oh, rise above it. And I'm like, you don't know what it's like. Rising above it is boring, man. Get in it and fucking rock it out and then...
I think it's fun to get there. I sometimes get involved in ones where they haven't even added me in. That's where it becomes really good fun. Because
they're like, dude, we did not ask for this. And you're like, well, I put a dot in front of your name and everyone who follows me, you're a bully.
I would take out people's names if I did. But I sometimes respond to something. And if it's not too unpleasant, even if it's a bit unpleasant, sometimes it's quite interesting to go, why do you think that? I think it's good. People say it's vanity searching to search for your own name on Twitter. But I don't think it is, because you actually...
Also really hard if you know it's there. And sometimes you need to do it for certain things that you're doing if you need to, like, forward something. Like, that sounds so, like, bad. But it's just really hard
if you know it's there.
It's like...
It's human nature.
Maybe I'll find out a secret about the future. Like, they'll say, Josie Long will find a pot of gold tomorrow. I am
on Twitter? Or on the
Twitter?
Internet.
Yeah. I wouldn't Google myself because of all the abuse, but... Twitter's fine on the whole.
Yeah. I had a look earlier. They were really having to go. No, I didn't. I did not. What is the closest you have come to death?
Oh, I was in a really serious car crash.
Yes, I remember.
But
how was that?
Nobody was injured.
No.
I can say what happened, and you won't believe that nobody died. It's insane, right? Me and my friends were driving from a gig in Swansea to a gig in Macuncliffe. And there were three of us. There was James Acaster, the incredible comedian, who is so upbeat and so silly and so full of joy. And he was driving. Shit driver, though, terrible driver. he was driving. I was in the passenger seat, and my friend Johnny, who's a really good friend of mine, a fantastic musician, was sat in the back there. And then just behind us, we had, like, all of this shit not tied down. Like, there was a guitar literally poking into the back of my head, and then behind us there were like boxes of all my fanzines and like all our stuff, right? And the car was really full. We're in this little Ford car, I think it was, which I now, whenever I see him, I'm like, you're all right, mate, just keep me safe. And we're going along this road, and it's like an A road, so not very big, and it's all windy, and there's trees on either side, so you can't really see what's going on. And we were stuck behind this lorry full of logs, and we were in convoy. There was a car in front of us, which had Henry Widdicombe, who runs Macuncliffe Comedy Festival, and he's an incredible human being, and Carl Chappell, who's a portrait painter. I'm just putting these details in because I can, right? And they overtook really easily. And it was a really long lorry. It was like uncut logs.
Yeah.
So fucking tree-length logs, right? And I can't believe that I was like this to James, but I was like, we should overtake. And he's like, well, I don't know. And then we kept trying. We're like, wait, no. And I should say at this point, we've been listening to two things that day. In the hire car, there came free a Mumford & Sons CD, right? And he just bought CeeLo Green's album. I had that song, I see you driving around town with the girl I love. Right? That's the bit to sing that you'll remember. And then... there's a CD, which we've been listening to that, right? And we kept trying to overtake and couldn't. And then eventually it was just so long and flat. And I was like, let's just fucking do it, we'll overtake. And we nearly finished overtaking. And then out of nowhere, there's a bend in the road. And then out of nowhere, three cars come around the bend. And James is like, fuck. And I'm like, fuck. And then one hits us head on. And then we're like ricochet between the car and the lorry, right? And then I saw the cab of the lorry just coming round into my view, right? And at that point, I just closed my eyes because I just thought, you're going to be crushed to death, you're going to die now. And like, bizarrely, I've had all these dreams where I get shot and I know I'm dying, but I know I'm alive still. And I'm like, well, mate, we're going to die, so we might as well lie still. So that's what's going to happen. So then in my head, I was like, oh, this is like all those dreams you've had. You're going to die, just lie still, because that's what to do. So I was kind of calm and I had my eyes closed. And then I was like, this is funny. It's like being on a roller coaster because there's always that jolting and noises. And then I remembered that 3 days previous, we'd seen the film Due Date, which I give 5 stars.
It'd been terrible if you died at this point after ingesting so much awful pop music and films.
That would be the last film I'd seen. Yeah. It's Due Date. And so I remembered in that, they have a car crash and he doesn't get injured because he's asleep.
Right.
So in my head, I was like, dude, just relax, we're going to die, and if we don't die, we need to pretend we're asleep. That's not how I sound to myself in my head. I'm trying to jazz it up a bit. And I so I had my eyes closed, and I could feel it smashing. I hear all these sounds, so loud sounds, but we were all silent in the car. We were all just like, fuck. And then when I came to, we were off the road against the tree, and there was a log there, a log there, and a log there, and the car was all buckled under, right? And I didn't know what had happened. And Henry Widdicombe, who'd been driving the front car, took ages to come back to us because the car crash happened. We ran out the car and we were standing in the field, like hugging each other, just weeping, like, I'm alive. And Henry came really slowly back and he was like, and he just looked haunted when he saw us. And he was like, I was so certain you were dead. I didn't want to come back quickly because I didn't want to see you dead. And we were like, what are you talking about? And basically, what happened was, instead, it wasn't that the lorry spun round, it's that our car spun out, got caught on the front of the lorry. The lorry, like, went up the road with us for a bit, then it swerved, took us off the road up a grass verge, crashed through a greenhouse belonging to this old lady, right? Back down, then because it had gone up and round, it kind of jackknifed, it, like, went over our bonnet, peeling it up like a sardine tin, then flipped over, then all the logs came off the lorry, pushed our car off the road into a tree, and then the logs came through our windscreen, and nobody was injured at all in the car. Nobody died at all, and we all got out of that car. And I remember thinking, what was fucking bizarre is before that happened, I remember having loads of thoughts where I was like, so weird, I've never been in a car crash, but I'm due a car crash. And also thinking, do you know what? I've never felt an airbag. That must be really fun. Oh, an airbag. How exciting. And then I remember thinking that when I woke up, I was like, oh, airbag. And then we had to get out of the car. And I was so pleased with how fucking gung-ho and macho I was. Like, recently, like, I've been really proud of myself thinking, I'm a fucking survivor, mate. I survive anything. And there were windows, and I smashed the window with my elbow, and then I, like, climbed out, and thereupon I got the only injury anyone got. I got a tiny cut on my thumb, right? And we ran out, and there was all glass in my shoes, my socks, my pants, everything. Right? And I was, like, running out, getting all this glass out, and we're like, and then, because I've seen films, two things. Right. Firstly, I thought I was dead and didn't realise it.
Yeah.
So I was like looking at it like, classic.
I'm still thinking that.
Yeah, I was like, classic. Classic dead and don't realise it, right? And secondly, I was convinced the car was going to explode. And even though we were like 20 feet away from it, I was in such a high state of shock that I was like, we need to take the keys out of the ignition because otherwise the car's going to explode. But then check this out, right? I'm such a fucking coward that I persuaded James Acaster. So I was like, the car's going to explode. James, you better get the keys out of the car. And then he ran and got them, and then he's running back, and he's got the car keys in one hand, and in his other hand, he's got the CeeLo Green CD. And he's like, I've got it, I've got it. And it also transpired that when we all thought we were going to die, I had Mumford and Sons in my head of, you really fucked it up this time. And they had, fuck you. And that's what we would have died, thinking our last thoughts.
Yeah.
And then what happened was, we had to wait in the old lady's house. Who's greenhouse?
She was furious.
She fucking hated us.
Yeah.
And it was so wrong, right? She gave us cups of tea with sugar in, which I would never normally have because it's not a cake, it's a fucking drink. But it was so good. And she didn't give us any food. And she blatantly had loads of food in the house. And I was looking at her like, you fucking cunt. You Tory cunt. Like, who would not give food to someone who's just probably dead?
She's probably saying you could have had some tomatoes if you hadn't crashed into the... greenhouse.
But then I'll tell you interesting, right? Because I'm quite chubby, and my friend Johnny is like not a chubby, but like not a skinny guy, and James is really skinny. And what happened was that night we went up the shop and bought loads of drink, loads of chocolate, and then I ordered a Chinese takeaway for like it was in we were in Barry Island, so it would have been very cheap to order a normal amount of takeaway. And I think I spent like 50 quid on this takeaway. It was like really hard to do. I had to be like, we'll get four of them and we'll get three of your banquets. And then we had this massive feast, and me and Johnny were like, I'm alive, I'm alive. And James just couldn't eat anything, and I was like, oh, this is why I'm chubby and skinny. I understand about life now. But it changed my life as well.
Did it? So unlike Danny Baker, who nearly died from cancer and didn't learn a thing,
I felt like it made me more political, and I felt like it meant I was more productive, and I left someone who I've been living with which was very sad and very hard, but I think it meant that I sort of woke up to that and I didn't do fuck all else. Oh, I stopped dieting forever that day. Because up until then I'd been like, oh, I hate myself, oh, I can't eat carbohydrates. Oh. And now I'm like, no, fuck it, which is a great thing.
Yeah. Because now you're just a ghost. You can eat what you like. Yeah.
That is... But I can't drink because then it goes out the holes of my belly.
Well, that would have been... I always think, you know, whenever I'm driving, I have exactly the same things, thoughts. Because I think, you know... But I always think there's so many comedians are driving around at late at night. This was in the daytime, presumably, was it?
It was.
Overtaking people.
And then afterwards, all the paramedics, all the police, everyone, the man at the car pound, impound, whatever, kept going, you should be dead. Thanks. I'm not. Yeah. Do you always keep thinking that...
I think I'm amazed there are less crashes, though there have been. Russell Howard actually has had a car crash as well.
Has he?
Yeah. So there are people who have had car crashes
but
and walked away.
But when he did it, 10,000 people were involved.
But it was quite it was his fault, and there were quite a lot of cars, but everyone was all right, so it's okay. Rob Delaney's been in a car.
There's this thing about moral luck. Because everyone was all right, we're all fine, but people could have, we could have all died. And wouldn't be much of a laugh.
And the people in the car you crashed into were all right as well.
They were fine, but they were fucked off. And the guy in the lorry, when we were trying to overtake him, he actually sped up a little bit just to be a cunt, right? And afterwards he came up to James and he was like, are you happy now? Are you happy now? And we were like, right, just nearly done, mate. And then we were like, yeah, mate.
Yeah, we're going to have a big Chinese takeaway. It's the best.
Oh, it's brilliant. It was the best night of my life, mate. And then we played board games and it was good. It's good to be alive.
It is. It's a shame because, you know, if you, Russell Howard and James Acaster had died, that is three of my competition out. That bumps me slightly higher up.
You think that?
I think like that. That's how I think. It's all a competition.
What's the prize? Death.
The prize is to get to the end of your life and realise you're nothing but a hollow shell and you've wasted your life.
I had a real theory for a while that every time you did a stand-up gig, it used up a little bit of your vital essence as a human being.
I used to have a theory when I was 14 that every time you masturbated, that would lessen the life of the earth. And at one point, I thought if I masturbated 100 more times, the world would end. And I didn't stop masturbating at all.
You were like...
If anything, I sped it up a bit.
Why did you think about that in relation to the earth?
Because you were kind of guilt. You thought you were doing something that was wrong, didn't you? So you thought there would be repercussions for doing something bad.
But I just thought it'd be like a thing that me and God would have to talk about.
Yeah, no, the world would end. That's how that's how important my cock is to me. Just in case anyone, I was joking about wishing these people to be dead, just that everyone took it quite seriously. I'm very happy with the way my life is going. I'm glad to be. But I also think, what will be the last thing you're listening to when you die? I think about the airbags all the time. I think, it's a shame I've got these airbags that never get used.
It was good, but it was weird. It had covered in talc.
Yeah,
right?
There you go.
We
see?
Know how that gets there. And it was like a latex glove.
What if they had an airbag that was a breast? That shot out, so it came out, and then you. Because even then, if you died, it would be kind of. If it was like a really realistic breast, you went into, and some talc came on there as well, and just go, well, you know, at least I'm dead, but I ended my life with my face in a breast.
But I think as a straight woman, my concerns would be slightly different. I'd be
like, I don't think you'd like
whose breast is this? What has happened to her?
It would be a cyborg's breast,
but it's a robot breast.
But it would be very much like a human being's. Breast. It would be good for us. We all like breasts. You know, they nurture us.
I'm not very interested though.
Nurture us at birth and death. That would be kind of a beautiful symmetry. No one's going with it. I thought at least some good has come out of that car crash we've invented. Have you ever come up with anything for Dragon's Den? Because I'm going to take that into Dragon's Den.
You can have it with my blessing.
The airbag. Did you get out of the car and when you realised you're all alive, goes James Acaster and say, who's going to have this for their Edinburgh show?
No, but weirdly, I did talk about it and I did feel uncomfortable talking about it because I didn't mention him by naming it, I just explained, but it did feel because it was such an oddly shared experience and all of us were standing there and it was like, we're really bonded together now because we nearly, and I do sort of still really care about them loads. Yeah. And it was very odd that we all nearly died together.
It is very odd, it sounds awful. I, for one, I'm quite glad
but it's so
that
odd.
None of you died.
But it was so horrific. But because no one's hurt, it's like this kind of like all's well that ends well jape. But it's like horrific and crazy that we didn't die. Like the car was like all mangled up, and then where Johnny was, the roof was caved in and the side was caved in. Like the fucking hand of death was trying to grab him, but it couldn't pick him up. Yeah.
Do you think it might end up being like Final Destination and you'll all be picked off one by one?
If so, it wasn't it 3.5 years ago?
Yeah.
So I'd say, fuck it, I've had a good innings in between. No, I've enjoyed myself.
Oh, good. Well, I am quite glad you're still alive, and we'll... on balance...
You're a good friend.
On balance. So there's things that are bad about you, though, you know, so they would have been wiped out. The bad things would have...
What are the worst
the
things?
The evil things.
What's the worst you? Thing about me?
There's nothing. You're just sweetness and light. You ate all my chocolate in Edinburgh that time.
I fucking didn't. It was just at Mark's. I only had one little bit.
You smashed that woman's greenhouse.
I'll fucking do it again.
You broke all those tables in Oxford. There's a whole litany.
That's because we had a game which was who can get the most people on a table.
Who can smash the most tables. No respect for tables.
It's the engineering
faculty. You're like Jesus
faculty.
Christ in that you have survived and you smash tables. Yeah, I thought it was better than that. Still not good enough to end on. We're going to have to come up with a topper. That might
can
be
I have one of your mugs?
Yes.
Can I, really?
Yeah.
Right.
Which one do you want? Oh, you've not taken the snooker one, I notice. There's badges in there as well. You can have a badge if you want. You have to pay for the badges. You have to pay £1. We never use the mugs. They're mugs, you can get them from richardherring.com. I would like to use your near death as a merchandising opportunity. I might get a picture of you in the car going...
What was weird afterward, I didn't trust buildings. I was in buildings and I'd be like, the ceiling's about to fall down. We all know it.
Yeah.
Didn't happen though.
Are you still feeling that a bit now? Don't worry, we're in a theatre. Nothing can possibly go wrong. Josie, it's been lovely to talk to you. We give a massive round of applause to Josie Long, ladies and gentlemen. How'd you like them sky potatoes?